بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هولاند، welcome back to my lecture Hypertension in Pregnancy Part 3. This part will be about eclampsia, HELLP syndrome, and chronic hypertension in pregnancy. So, what is eclampsia? When preeclampsia complicated with grand mal seizures, that's to say generalized tonic-clonic seizures and or coma, is called eclampsia. It complicates about 10% of all pregnancies, about 1 to 2% of preeclamptic pregnancies, and may be the initial presentation of preeclampsia and may occur before hypertension or proteinuria. The incidence about 38% antepartum, mostly in the third trimester, and about 18% intrapartum, and the largest incidence, which is about 44% postpartum, usually within 48 hours. So, fits beyond 7 days generally rules out eclampsia. What are the clinical features of eclampsia? Eclamptic convulsions are epileptiform and consist of 4 stages. Premonitory stage, which is a twitching of muscles of the face, tongue, limbs, and eyes, eyeballs ruled or turned to one side. Tonic stage, which is opistotonos, limbs flexed, hands clenched. Clonic stage, which lasts about 1 to 4 minutes, frothing, tongue bite, and stertorous breathing. Stage of coma of variable period. How can you manage eclampsia? The aim of your management is to control hypertension, improve intravascular volume, prevent convulsions, prevent complications, and deliver a viable fetus. So, when you have a patient in the emergency room with seizure because of eclampsia, what will you do? You will call for help. You will do ABC and IV access. You will give magnesium sulfate, loading and maintenance dose. Strict monitoring to the vital signs every 15 minutes. You will measure the urine output hourly. Assess the reflexes. If blood pressure is more than 160 over 110, you will give antihypertensives. Fluid restriction. CVP line may be needed. CTG monitoring for the fetus. Deliver when the mother is stable. Vaginally, of course, if the cervix is favorable. If HELLP coexist, that's to say hemolysis and so on, high dose steroids, renal and liver physicians must be available. In the third stage, you will give oxytocin, but not methergine or ergometrine because of risk of elevation of blood pressure. Medical management for severe hypertension, preeclampsia, and eclampsia in general, if a woman in a critical care setting who has severe hypertension or severe preeclampsia or previously had an eclamptic fit, you must give her magnesium sulfate if birth is planned within 24 hours. In case of ongoing or recurring severe headache, visual disturbance, nausea, vomiting, epigastric pain, oliguria, and severe hypertension, or progressive deterioration in lab test, that's to say liver function test, renal function test, or falling of platelet count. About magnesium sulfate, you will give loading dose, 4 grams should be given slowly, IV, and then infusion maintenance dose, 1 gram per hour, and the infusion should be continued for 24 hours after the last fit. If recurrent fit occur, you will treat it with further loading dose, also IV slowly. Don't use diazepam, phenytoin, or other anticonvulsant as alternative to magnesium sulfate in women with eclamptic fit. Control hypertension, most commonly for acute control, by labetalol, which is the first line, avoid tenesmo, hydralazine, vasodilator, or nifedipine may be used, but unexpected hypotension may occur when you give it with magnesium sulfate. And when you give hydralazine, there will be risk for hypotension, so consider using IV fluid. This schedule for antihypertensive agents used in urgent blood pressure control in pregnancy, you see it before. First line is labetalol, hydralazine, nifedipine, with their doses, and comment about their contraindications and complications, side effect. About treatment with magnesium sulfate, if toxicity happen with magnesium sulfate, that's to say these signs, confusion, loss of reflexes, respiratory depression, and hypotension, you will stop magnesium sulfate, you will give antidote, calcium gluconate, oxygen must be given, and secure airway and ventilation. Now we will speak about HELP syndrome. HELP syndrome is a variant of severe preeclampsia which manifests with hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes, and low platelets. About 5 to 10% of preeclamptic pregnancies can complicate to HELP syndrome. Maternal mortality about 1%, perinatal mortality about 10 to 60%. Liver enzymes will increase, platelet decrease before hemolysis occur. The syndrome usually self-limiting, but permanent liver and renal damage may occur. What are the symptoms of HELP syndrome? Epigastric or right upper quadrant pain, nausea and vomiting, urine become decolored due to hemolysis. What are the signs? There will be tenderness on palpation in right upper quadrant, increased blood pressure and other features of preeclampsia. Eclampsia may coexist, and at this time, delivery is indicated. How can you manage patient with HELP syndrome? Treatment is supportive, as for eclampsia. That's to say, you will give magnesium sulfate. Although platelet levels may be very low, platelet infusion are only indicated if bleeding or if you will do surgery and the platelet is less than 40. Don't use dexamethasone or betamethasone, that's to say cortisone, for the treatment of HELP syndrome. So, you will be aware of epigastric pain in any pregnant and immediately postnatal women. Always check blood pressure, urine, and liver enzymes. That's to say, think about HELP syndrome. Chronic hypertension in pregnancy. What is a chronic hypertension in pregnancy? It is the presence of hypertension of any cause antedating or before the 20th week of a pregnancy and beyond the 12th week after delivery. Women with chronic hypertension are low risk and have satisfactory maternal and fetal outcome without any hypertensive therapy by just lifestyle modification and aerobic exercise. What are the risk factors for chronic hypertension in pregnancy? Old age women, that's to say more than 40 years, duration of hypertension long time more than 15 years, level of blood pressure more than 160 over 110, presence of any medical disorder, presence of thrombophilia. What is the effect of chronic hypertension on pregnancy? For the maternal side, there will be risk for superimposed preeclampsia or eclampsia in about 15 to 20% of cases. Fetal complications is intrauterine growth retardation and risk for intrauterine death, fetal death. How can you do fetal monitoring in patient with chronic hypertension? By ultrasound for fetal growth, amniotic fluid volume, and umbilical artery Doppler. And this checking, this control, will be done in week 28, week 32, and 36 weeks of gestation. Prenatal care for chronic hypertension. You will do ECG for the mother, should be obtained in women with long-standing hypertension. Baseline laboratory tests, you will do urine analysis, urine culture, serum creatinine, that's to say renal function test, glucose and electrolyte level, test will rule out renal disease and identify comorbidities such as diabetes mellitus, because patients with chronic hypertension are liable for other chronic diseases, especially diabetes mellitus. Women with a proteinuria on a urine dipstick should have a quantitative test for urine protein, that's to say collection of protein for 24 hours. Management of a chronic hypertension in pregnancy. Pre-pregnancy advice: offer the woman with chronic hypertension referral to a specialist in hypertensive disorder of pregnancy to discuss the risk and benefit of a treatment. Advise the women who take angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitors or angiotensin II receptor blockers that there may be an increased risk of congenital abnormalities and neonatal complications if these drugs are taken during pregnancy, in order to discuss alternative antihypertensive treatment. Offer pregnant women with chronic hypertension advice on weight management, exercise, healthy eating, lowering the amount of salt in their diet, continue with existing antihypertensive treatment if safe in pregnancy, or switch to alternative treatment, unless sustained systolic blood pressure less than 110, sustained diastolic blood pressure less than 70, or women has symptomatic hypotension. That's to say, she will never need to continue her antihypertensive if she is hypotensive. Offer antihypertensive treatment to pregnant women who have a chronic hypertension and who are not already on a treatment if they have sustained systolic blood pressure of 140 millimeter of mercury or higher, sustained diastolic blood pressure of 90 millimeter of mercury or higher, and the target blood pressure must be 135 over 85 millimeter of mercury. You will consider as a treatment labetalol, as we said, as first line, nifedipine for women in whom labetalol is not suitable, or methyldopa if both labetalol or nifedipine not suitable. Base the choice on any pre-existing treatment or the side effect of the drug, risk factor for the baby, and women preferences. Offer a pregnant woman with chronic hypertension aspirin. This is important. Low-dose aspirin, 75 milligram, once daily from 12th week gestation. What about timing of birth? Don't offer planned early birth before 37 weeks, that's to say before term, to women with chronic hypertension whose blood pressure is lower than 160 over 110, with or without antihypertensive treatment, unless there are other medical indications for termination of pregnancy. Postnatal investigations and monitoring. Aim is to keep blood pressure lower than 140 over 90. Continue antihypertensive treatment if required. If a woman has taken methyldopa to treat chronic hypertension during pregnancy, she must stop it within 2 days after birth. Why? Or change to other alternative antihypertensive treatment. Why? Because of high risk for postpartum depression, as we said before. Offer a review of antihypertensive treatment 2 weeks after birth with a GP doctor or specialist, and general medical review about 6 to 8 weeks after birth with GP or specialist doctor. What about lactation? Most antihypertensive medications taken while breastfeeding only lead to very low levels in breast milk. So, the amount taken in by baby are very small and would be unlikely to have any clinical effect. So, it is okay for breastfeeding with most of antihypertensive drugs. Offer enalapril, for example, nifedipine, amlodipine, adding atenolol or labetalol to the combination treatment, but use medications that are taken once daily when possible for the patient's compliance. Well, with this slide, I will finish my lecture. I would like to thank you very much. Thank you for your attention. I wish you a good luck in your study, and goodbye.